You're in charge, so if you want to call the meeting to order, you may.
I'll go ahead and call to order the April 5th Salina City Planning Commission Meeting. First order of business is approval of summary minutes of the March 4th regular meeting.
I'd move that the minutes be approved as printed.
I would second that, but with the caveat that on page 5 of the minutes, just to be accurate, at the top of the page, it mentions my reference to Bill McKibben should be McKibben, M-C-K-I-B-B-E-N, and probably should mention his organization, 350.org, of 350.org. And I think that would be a complete reference.
I have a motion and a second with a friendly amendment regarding the spelling of and the address of.
350.
Okay. Yeah.
Confused with Mr. Household.
Anybody else have any discussion on that before we vote on it? All in favor?
Aye.
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 Passes unanimously. Thank you. Item number 2.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. We're just bringing this to you for a request for your assistance. And by way of background, there was a case that was heard back in the year 1995, 1996, where there was a plan put forward by Wheat State Carriers to construct a truck maintenance facility on Pleasant Hill Road. And as you can imagine, with your knowledge of that area and the problems, there were several financial obstacles and a great deal of discussion about financing options for upgrading that road to a paved street standard. And the fact that there was no public utilities extended to that site, and there was a determination eventually on their part that the combined costs were too great. And so then there was some creativity applied in an attempt to do a planned commercial district. And on March 5th, 1996, you recommended approval as a planning commission to change the zoning from C5 to Plan C5. And you approved this plan for the property, which was the construction of an office building and a garage building that was contingent on them actually being able to get utilities to the site. And then there was somewhat of a compromise made on the paving of parking and driveways and maneuvering areas. And there was work by staff and others trying to come up with a meaningful benefit district that would allow for paving from 9th Street over to the driveway entrance to the site. None of that came about, and the City Commission did concur with your recommendation, and they adopted an ordinance that incorporated that plan. And I would point your attention on page 2 to item 6, which says that development of the sites shall substantially conform to the approved site plan and associated submittals. So this was the plan that was approved for the property. There was also a provision in our planned commercial district regulations that states that if the applicant fails to obtain a building permit within the valid time limit, the site development plan shall deem to be revoked, and the subject property shall automatically revert to its former zoning classification. And so this property was never built upon, so the zoning change and site plan approved have essentially expired. And the language that's there on page 3 indicates that it would automatically revert back to its former C5 zoning, which basically means that we would show it on our official map as C5 instead of planned C5. We also noted in there, and the reason we're here today is that we think a more formal and better documented step would be to formally rescind or repeal the ordinance rezoning the property. And since I've got two examples, but since Mr. Welsh is not here, I can pick on him. He had a piece of property out at the northwest corner of Holmes Road and Crawford Street, had similar challenges to this property, unimproved, unpaved street, had a need for utility extensions and cooperation with adjoining owners. He got that a plat and a zoning request approved on first reading, and then was given 12 months and then a 24-month extension to finalize a plat of the property. And the timing was just not right out there, so the city commission went back and repealed the ordinance that they had approved on first reading to rezone that property. So it is still zoned agricultural today, even though there was once an ordinance that intended to rezone it. So we think it's a better step and better documentation for everyone involved to formally rescind or repeal an ordinance. And the other thing we pointed out was back in 2011, you also had several public hearings on this property about a request to rezone this to light industrial for a towing service or wrecker service impound yard. And you denied that request, and the request was withdrawn. So what our current status on this property is that, as you are aware, it is a floodplain piece of property, which, again, distinguishing floodplain from floodway, floodplain means that you are low and subject to back up flooding or surface flooding, but it is possible to elevate and build in the floodplain. However, it does require filling permits and plans to show how you're going to elevate and import fill to do before you do any earthwork. In addition to that, you are aware that it's relatively inaccessible from 9th Street because of the condition of the road, and it lacks public utilities. So what we have out there that's different than the aerial photo that you see in this picture, and John, I don't know if you've been showing the pictures of the current condition, but this is the current condition use of the property, and we are requesting that all these trailers be removed from the property. There are no improvements or any surfacing on the lot, just open storage on what was formerly a wheat field. And because of the C5 zoning and the surfacing requirements in that district, this is not a permissible use. And so there seemed to be some concern or belief that because back in 1996, wheat state carriers would have been allowed to build a building and defer paving until there was a plan for paving the street, that somehow applies to the property currently, and that is not the case in staff's belief. So our request is that you would reaffirm that the wheat state carrier zoning change and site plan have expired, and that the Planning Commission approve a motion to recommend that the 1996 planned commercial district that was created for this property be repealed and rescinded, just to document that those conditions are no longer in place. So with that, I'd be happy to address any questions, but you have a copy of the correspondence from staff requesting the removal of the material from the property, and we would be open to any questions that commissioners might have.
Any questions?
When these expirations come up, is there any kind of docket where you would, feeling we should be doing this with all cases?
Yeah, I think, and we will discuss that with Mr. Banks and the city attorney. That was kind of put in there to try to simplify it. It really works pretty good with the site plan. The idea, we're going to have an item coming up later with the City Commission where a 1979 site plan is going to be rescinded because that's the only thing that can be built on the property. So what you don't want is you don't want a plan that stays binding on a piece of property forever. But it's one thing to automatically expire on a site plan. You can time that out pretty well. What doesn't work so well is that even though this says it will automatically revert to its former zoning classification, there's still a zoning ordinance that's on the books of the City of Salina that said that this has Plan C5 zoning, and I think the best course of action moving forward is, and we don't have this happen very often, which is why you don't see a lot of these, although you did in the case of the Holiday Inn that's being constructed out in front of Lowe's. You approved their zoning and their site plan, and they went 18 months and didn't build anything, so they came back to you for an extension. But this was 1996, and all extensions have run out. So we don't have very many of these, but it for the city clerk, for record keeping, for a lot of reasons, having a record that this ordinance that was adopted by the City Commission actually be formally repealed, we think is the best way to go.
Would Mr. Welsh's example fit in the same category? I mean, there's cleanups to do.
Yeah, the difference is there's no provision there for about automatically repealing. So we had a similar case. If you are familiar with Magnolia Hills Estates, which is on the west side of Markley Road, just to the west of the Covenant Church there. In 2007, those developers came in. They filed an application to plat, annex, and zone that property. And then the market kind of took a downturn. And so they decided not to proceed with platting the property. And the City Commission had approved an ordinance rezoning that to residential, and he didn't plat it within 12 months, so they repealed that ordinance. It's mostly for tracking purposes. The city has a record of ordinances adopted since the 1860s, and you can find an ordinance, you can find the outcome of that. The part of it is for tracking purposes to say this ordinance was passed, but it is now repealed and it doesn't have any validity. And so since this happens so seldom, we think the automatic reversion might work on a map, but it doesn't work with the fact that you have an ordinance 969730 that's still out there, and there needs to be a action to repeal the approval of that change.
Dean, I don't mind bringing this back. I understand that's not my point here, but it seems to me under Section 42.415 B and C of the Planning Commercial District Regulations, it automatically reverted after 18 months. Is that correct?
That is correct.
So it would be, in my opinion, a mere cleanup item on the commission's and docket to say these particular parcels in the City of Salina have not been developed per the guidelines or your regulations.
And they should be brought back for repeal. And
yeah, it should be brought to the commission, not the Planning Commission, for a hearing.
Right.
They'd already been heard, and they knew what they had to do. It's like telling someone no twice. There's no reason for that. It's just a cleanup item on the commission, the City Commission's docket.
It could very well be that way in the future.
And I'm afraid if we set a precedence of each one that has this regulation, and then we bring it back for another hearing before the Planning Commission, then we sort of owe that to everybody. You failed to do that, and then I would think they might have an argument. Well, you didn't treat me the same as the last person. Okay.
Part of the reason for bringing this to the Planning Commission today is to see if you agree with staff that this is a violation of the C5 zoning district regulations and a violation of your 2011 action where you denied the rezoning of the property to use this as a wrecker service impound yard. Part of it is we didn't believe it was your expectation that when you denied that in 2011 that this is what was going to occur.
I agree.
And I agree also. I have a question before I do this. This, in fact, though, is a public hearing item.
That is correct.
And in order to keep with the procedure that we've used all along, we always allow any member of the public who has an interest or information to share with us to do so. So I'm going to open this at this time and see if there's any member of the public who would like to speak regarding this issue. Come up, please, and just when you get up to the microphone, give us your name, your address, please.
I'm Leroy Schmidt, 2535 Linda Lane.
Thank you.
Line.
Good.
the only question I have, are you reverting this back to farmland, or are you reverting this back to C5?
Reverting it back to C5.
Okay. That was probably my only question I got.
It was C5 before, and then it went to a plan C5 with these stipulations, and it would go back from, revert from plan C5 back to straight C5 zoning.
Okay. Right. Now, you also mentioned that in 211, you turned us down on a salvage yard.
On the wrecker.
On the wrecker service.
Service.
We do not have a wrecker service in there this time.
That is correct.
I want you to know that. So
right.
We are not arguing that point whatsoever.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Schmidt. I appreciate
that.
Someone else?
Yes. My name is Roy Palmer, 7925 West Pleasant Hill Road. And my question is, or one of them, is that when we purchased this property, it was assumed that it was a PC5. And according to the PC5 and the paperwork we had here, we would not have to do any rocking or anything to the property until the Culver Road was paved. And then we had 12 months to take care of our end of the deal on bringing our property up to standard according to the paperwork from the city. Okay. The property to the straight west of us is supposedly the same zoning as we got. It may not be a PC5, it might be an I5 or something like that. And Dean specified to me that all the properties in that I-5 had to be concreted, parking and everything. No asphalt, millings, no rock, and parking areas in that I is not all concrete. They have asphalt millings. I tried to find some other properties in town under the same zonings, and I couldn't get none to give me none that I could verify more properties that have gravel lots and stuff. And I think that he just wants to try to get that change back because it might fall under some other regulation that we would have to do to maintain being able to park, have off-street parking for trailers or trucks.
Sure.
Or whatever. It's off-street parking, which I-5 or PC-5 should be able to do no matter what.
Well, and I don't know exactly when you purchased the property, but looking at this, I would say that somewhere in 1998, for sure by 1999, mm-hmm. It was no longer zoned the way you thought it was.
Okay.
So if you bought it in 2005,
okay,
it wasn't zoned the way you are telling me you thought it was zoned.
So does the I-5 have to have concrete through all the parking areas there?
What part of the reason that we brought this here today is that staff, if you look at the listing of items on page 2, which was part of the Planning Commission stipulations back in 1996, first of all, it says permitted uses shall be limited to a truck maintenance facility, which there's no truck maintenance facility on the property. Sixth item says development of the site shall substantially conform to the approved site plan and associated submittals. John, could you put the approved site plan up again, please? Okay, the property has not been developed in accordance with this site plan. And then, thirdly, because 18 months went by and Wheat State Carriers did not develop under this plan, all of those stipulations went away. And so we're saying that stipulation number two, which we might add, doesn't say that you can park trailers on unsurfaced areas. It just says you can have an all-weather surface instead of a paved with concrete or asphalt. This was allowed for Wheat State Carriers only in their particular plan for the property and does not carry over. So the purpose of this hearing is to see, to tell you what staff's interpretation is and to see if the Planning Commission agrees with that interpretation. And so our position is that none of the truck trailers that are on the property there today should be there under the current zoning on an unsurfaced area, and that nothing that was done in 1996 allows what you see there today.
Mr. Perlmutter, do you have anything else to share with this other than those two issues?
Yeah, I was wondering why this even came about, because it seemed like once I purchased the property and started using it, some sort of alarm system went off.
Yes. John, could you go back to the aerial photo, please?
And he's had trailers on that property since the day he bought it. Okay. And he has not had an issue with the city.
Let's look at this aerial photo.
There's two trailers out there.
We would not approve of that either at the time.
Years ago.
Mr. Schmidt has got notices years ago.
Pardon me, I've not got notices on my trailers.
Okay, you told me they weren't your trailers, so I guess that's my mistake.
I've had two trailers and three trailers on that lot since the day I bought it, and I've never had a word said about it. And I was hoping I could leave my trailer set there, because as far as I'm concerned, nobody really sees them. The people that are complaining live across the creek. They can't even see them from the trees. So I don't know why they are complaining. But I have had three trailers and two trailers on that lot since the day I bought it. And I have not ever had a word said about it until this.
Okay.
Thank you very much. I think I'm going to, if there are anybody else that has any comments, I'm going to bring it back here to the commission and see if you have any further questions that might involve the people, or else talk among yourselves.
Just for way of explanation, Mr. Schmidt is the record owner of the property, and Mr. Palmer is purchasing the property under contract from Mr. Schmidt. So under our rules for code enforcement, it is always the record owner who is ultimately responsible for what's taking place on a piece of property.
Go ahead.
The way I see we're sitting here now, it looks pretty well agreed that no one ever intends to reactivate the approved PC planned development of an office and a garage with a driveway. That's completely, the owner doesn't want to do that. No one wants to reactivate that. So our action here today is just to confirm that plan is in fact expired, and that the property should now be back to the standard C5 rules and regulations. Then these other problems about parking the trailer on there are code enforcement problems, not zoning problems per se.
Well, they relate to surfacing.
But we're not a code enforcement body.
Right. You are here to tell us whether you concur that everything that happened in 1996 has expired, and we're back to just looking at what C5
allows. And your recent letter outlines the things that the present owners would have to do in order to park trailers on there as a straight C5 property.
That is correct.
They have to apply for fill permits, and they would have to apply for paving, and they would have to have some kind of a site plan that showed where the paving was going to be and landscaping that.
And I did want to point out that the new Petrolube truck lube facility that is on the west side of North 9th Street and located northwest of the Petro 2 convenience store, that property is zoned the same as this property.
C5.
And if you took and followed Mr. Palmer's theory, then we should have allowed the Petrolube over there to build their facility and leave the rest of their property as grass and dirt and not make them pave all their driveways and maneuvering areas for trucks. And so our purpose in doing this is that C5 zoning is a level playing field of rules, and if Petrolube has to pave their C5 zone lot for their business purposes, then this also has to be surfaced if it's going to be used for commercial purposes.
Mr. Palmer, I know you have something to say. I'm going to let you say that in just a minute, but I do want to make it real clear that whether or not something needs to be paved or what can be parked there or what can't be parked there is not part of what we're deciding today. We're deciding whether or not it does, in fact, go back to the original zoning, and that's all we're going to decide. So if there are issues about whether there should be 3 trucks or 30 trucks or 4 feet of concrete or 6 inches of asphalt, those are not issues that we will be able to help you with, okay?
But change,
all right, so go ahead.
But changing that from PC5 to I5?
C5.
Or C5, excuse me. Uh-huh. Isn't that going to change the things that the city would have to do, like in front of Petro, that he states their parking lot is concrete, but their street is concrete. On the PC5 over there where we're at, we're dirt road.
Okay.
And they want us to concrete it.
Right.
If we go back to the C5, then we're going to go into have to concrete right. a lot against right. a city street
that's dirt.
Gravel.
Right. But we're in the process of looking at and deciding whether, in fact, it is already a C5. And it appears, and I'm not speaking for this group, but as we look at it, it appears that it may have been that way for some 12 or 13 years already. That it's, it was not a PC5 2 weeks ago, 2 years ago.
Okay, but why would the city be allowed to have that on record that it was PC5 if it was supposed to go back to that? We purchased that under that assumption when we got with the city and asked them, you know.
Well, we're not here to help settle disagreements about owner and seller and that kind of thing. We're here just to affirm whether or not the zoning has changed. And so I think, unless you have something else, I think we're going to bring it back up here and see if the commission's ready to make an action.
Ask Dean one question.
Sure, yes. You may.
Dean, if we fence that with about an 8-foot fence, is that permissible?
With a permit?
Without concreting? Because I cannot concrete 5 acres. I can't.
Well,
if we had a nice fence.
Any portion of this is used for a commercial business purpose that relates to vehicles or vehicles going in and out or being stored or displayed, the surface needs to be paved with asphalt or concrete, or you need to once again come before this body and the city commission and persuade them or attempt to persuade them once again that this shouldn't be zoned C5, it should be zoned something else, realizing at the same time that this group and a committee of business owners is also looking at whether the paving requirement should be extended to industrial zones, which would then no longer distinguish industrial from commercial zones. But there, any C5 zone, any driveways, maneuvering areas, display areas, surface areas must be paved. And you have the same zoning as Marshall Motors and Long MacArthur Ford and Conklin Cars and all of those businesses, and they must pave the areas that they display their vehicles on, and the same rules apply to this as a C5 zoned property. And the only thing that could change that would be to make it industrial, and that was tried in 2011 and did not succeed, but it could be tried again.
All right. Thank you. I know this is confusing, and I appreciate you both coming today. Commission?
Mr. Chairman, if you'll entertain a motion, I would move that we affirm that the Wheat State Carriers zoning change prior has expired and approve a motion, make the motion to rescind the 96 planned commercial district.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye.
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 I really was going to make a comment between the second and the vote. May I make a comment now?
Yes, you can. I'm sorry.
You know, I agree 100% with the decision. I think it's an opportunity for us to tell possibly the community that it's always important to look into what the zoning is carefully on a piece of property before you purchase it. Not always does the seller nor does the buyer know what zoning is or what it requires, and the city's guidelines are pretty clear on all zoning, and zoning's there to protect the interests of the community as a whole, to make our community better, and I believe in those. So it's just incumbent, and I know we all forget that sometime, but it's incumbent to remember, work with the city closely when you purchase property, when you sell property, to follow the zoning requirements, which is very helpful and saves it coming back here a couple of times.
Thank you. That's good. Good comment. Anybody else? Well, I'm going to take just a second. It has nothing to do with the question that was before us. But when a property, the zoning expires or the zoning change expires, do we have a mechanism where we just as simply as send the property owner a letter stating that, which could then become a very easy documentation for, yes, you do. I mean, I know people forget and letters get misplaced and those kinds of things, but is it possible that 18 months after we have one of these, if nothing's done, we say, look, it's about ready to expire. If you want to extend it.
It could have or should have in this case. It may have been sent to the owner at the time. Mr. Schmidt did not own it back at that time. I did find in one case that you all may or may not have memories that stretch back, that where the Kansas Wesleyan maintenance facility is being has been finalized there on the east side of South 9th Street, that was a location that was rezoned for Sankey auto sales as a planned C5 district. Sankey then relocated to the corner of Ohio and Crawford and never developed the site the way he had originally intended. It expired, and we sent a letter to Mr. Sankey saying that the site plan and the planned C5 zoning on that site had expired. That did not cure the aspect of getting the ordinance off of the books. That's an internal matter for us, but it did establish a record that said on this date you were provided notice that you're reverted back to what you were before. In that case, it was a C3 that went to a planned C5, and it's zone C3 today.
All right. Anybody else want a piece of it? If not, we'll go on to item number 3.
One more comment,
okay.
In the ordinance, does it specifically state that it will revert back after
It does not in the ordinance, and that is somewhat problematic, and as we will work that out with Mr. Bankston, but our next step here will be to take your recommendation to the City Commission and place it on their agenda to formally repeal ordinance number 96-9730 off the books. And it does not say that. It does say that in section 42.415 that just basically says the approved plan should become null and void 18 months from the date of approval if a building permit has not been issued during that time period. And so the idea is that not to tie up pieces of property with specific development plans on them, but to open them back up for other choices. And so that is the ordinance as it was passed by the City Commission back in 1996, and it has those stipulations in it, but it's elsewhere that has the consequences if you don't do something in 18 months. Usually that is in the report that goes to the City Commission and to the applicant. So in the case of Holiday Inn, they knew that their 18 months was running out. That actually also happened with Lowe's. Lowe's got their property rezoned and had a plan approved and did not act on it within 18 months, and they requested an extension from the Planning Commission.
I'm certainly not criticizing. I'm just saying, if you're an armchair attorney and the right. ordinance actually says that in it, then it'd be clear right from the get-go rather than to have to know
that
more
is,
about the law and
that,
dig deeper.
That is correct. And their further research, we may be able to unearth that letter. I could not find a letter that went to Weed State Carriers telling them that their project had expired. That doesn't mean it didn't occur.
Yes, this will be the last one, however, because if there are things that you want to discuss with the planner directly, then you'll need to go ahead and make some office time for him to do that. But if it's something that's directed to this commission that we can do something about, fine. But if there's some, if we did this, could we, those will be things that you'll need to schedule with Dean in his office time. But I will let you ask your question, yes.
Well, I'm just curious on, if the city's stuff was supposed to revert back after how many months, Dean, 18?
18 months.
Why is the city still sending out the letters that say it was PC5 in 2013? If their records show that it should be back 18 months after the Wheat State stuff failed to go through, why are they still showing that it's PC5 in 2013? That's what I want to know. Is he's wanting to change from PC5 to the I-5. To the C5, excuse me.
That's all right. I understand that's confusing.
They didn't do their job in making sure that this was off the books as PC5.
I think, and then I think we're going to need to be done here, but the thing is, it did change. The issue we were trying to do, it changed by ordinance after 18 months. We didn't get the paperwork written down to change it. That didn't mean it didn't change. It just, you know.
It changes the property.
If I get a piece of mail at my house that was addressed to the person who owned it before I got there, that doesn't make that property that person's home any longer. It just means the post office didn't get the paperwork done. And I think that's a very simple way of looking at this. It did revert back 18 months afterwards. We were just cleaning that up so that it's clear to everyone.
And it does not make one whit of difference whether this property is C5 or Plan C5. What Mr. Palmer is using it for is not
That's
permitted.
Right.
And so all we brought this for you today was, it's basically, as Mr. Kennedy described it, as a housekeeping item, and it has nothing to do with the merits of how the property is used. And this case became instructive to us that the automatic expiration aspect of this does not work very well, that it needs to be brought back and say, here is something that has expired and is a housekeeping item. We need to clean it up.
Let's go ahead and move on to item number 3.
Yes.
We've got some follow-up recommendations and so forth regarding or relating to the North 9th Street corridor study. And Dean, I know there's some things in the packet here I've had a chance to look at. I don't know how to begin on this.
Well, there was some expression at the study session that it was a study session and there wasn't an opportunity for commissioners to take a position or make a recommendation or do something on the record that could be communicated to the City Commission. And just to summarize real quickly is that we wanted to explain to the Planning Commission that when we talk about the area between Euclid and I-70, It is primarily composed of floodway where new construction is extremely difficult, if not impossible. And we pointed out that there are 15 individual landowners that have property in there, and most of the development that is in there predates the 1986 floodplain program and mapping. And one of the reasons we had the study session was to ask how likely it was that any new development or redevelopment can or will occur there, and what would that likely be. And one of the questions is, if we really think it's going to be a corridor for development, do we want to be proactive and adopt standards and guidelines that influence that development as it occurs? And planning staff didn't see that corridor as a point of emphasis for overlay districts or design standards or guidelines, because we just don't see it as realistic that much is going to happen there commercially. And so there was some discussion about some possible capital improvement or flood control improvements that might make that corridor more developable. One that was discussed was taking a cutoff channel, and basically what happens is that you get Stemmel Road that runs along, and it will the water will essentially follow Stemmel Road here right to the east across Ohio and over to the Saline River. So there was some discussion, well, could you cut a channel like you have at the Schilling Road ditch and carry it over there? There was discussion about, could you take the flood control levee that runs here and bring it up alongside Mulberry Creek to provide additional flood protection? Could you build a dam and a reservoir on Mulberry Creek and have flood control and detention, and possibly even a reservoir that could be used for recreation or water supply? All of those are pretty big ticket items that have never appeared on any capital improvement program. And then, of course,
sorry, could I ask you a favor? Would you run the marker again where the levee? I want to be sure I
had the levee runs right here. Yeah. This is a mini storage facility. This is St. John's Military.
Right.
The levee runs right there. So our unprotected zone is through here.
Yeah,
and so the thought was, we'll take it from this point and run it along the channel and protect this property from that eastward flow.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, the other option is you construct no flood control improvements and you transition the corridor to public or semi-public open space over time. And then that deals with the infrastructure investment. The other thing is that we have this plan that shows that it's both conservation area and commercial. It's primarily shown that way because we have existing commercial there.
Right.
So one scenario would be to take steps to encourage commercial development and redevelopment, have a corridor overlay district or design guidelines. One would be to maintain the status quo. The other one would be to say, we see this as primarily a conservation area, we should discourage new development and transition this to public or quasi-public owned space over time. One of the things that came up, we had some representatives of the North Salina Development Group, and they reminded staff and the commission that there had been a workshop sponsored by EPA that took place up at St. John's Military School and had some pretty good citizen involvement, and we summarized some of their recommendations there on that handout. And some of the things they said was that there should be gateway landscape features installed at the interchange to create a sense of welcome or arrival. You have seen illustrations of a prototype design that would be just south of the interstate at the southwest corner of the interstate. This says the hotel at Southwest, and that's a direct quote, will be redeveloped. There was a strong sense of confidence of that at the time. A definitive strategy for site development that is appropriate in a flood zone needs to be developed. That strategy has not yet been developed. There hasn't been any engineering work done there. The property is now vacant. It's starting to deteriorate a little bit and become unsecure. So the certainty of that is certainly not there. They pointed out that the creeks present an opportunity for more formalized flood control measures. There are some green infrastructure strategies and things that you can do that are less structural that can aid in flood control that are more natural in setting. It recommended that this mobile home sales lot up there be converted to another use. Talked about making that a collection point for other activity. You could have a community garden and orchard. Might be a good place for plant sales or a trailhead or a farmer market or just passive park space. That's always a good use of floodway is open space or park space. Talks about public and natural areas on the north end of 9th Street, extending the levee trail, which we are attempting over time. The original plan was to have a trail on top of the levee all the way around the city. There actually are some fairly nice areas there on the levee at the north end that goes by Thomas Park and east of there in terms of bike riding or running. It's a fairly nice area, but not real accessible, and we're working that direction. There's talk about a public tree nursery, orchard, or space, potential for wind or solar generation in the floodplain. Talking about new mixed-use development, the gateway in the area of Euclid Avenue. And then it talked about, and again, this is outside the scope of this, but if there's an agreement on the vision for Euclid to I-70, then you still have the traveling public and visitors are going from Euclid down to the five corners, and what strategies are there for that corridor of 9th Street between Euclid and five corners, and there were some few thoughts about that. So that is a summary of what came out of citizen input from the EPA workshop on North 9th. And so we brought this back from the study session to this to see if a majority of commissioners wanted to make any specific recommendations or comments or take a formal position that you wanted communicated on to the city commission. I will, just as an aside, it's so eye-popping that you almost have to think twice to digest it, but we talked with Martha Tasker, our utilities director. There has been an ongoing raw water supply study for Salina to look at options for improving our storage of water for access for dry periods. And one of the options they looked at was construction of a reservoir for water storage. And based on the complexity and the cost and the land acquisition, that was near the bottom of their list for options for storage because of the complexity and costliness, and the estimate that they came up with to construct a water supply reservoir with the design, construction, maintenance was $162 million.
How big a hole is that?
It's a big hole.
It's a large area. I'll try to look at how many surface feet or the total gallons that they were. It was 25,000 acre feet.
Can you mention some of the others?
They did not have a specific location identified, but they were just looking at the various intricacies of the whole approval process for constructing new dams.
Seems like a lot, but it pales in comparison to running out of water in a community.
Right. Well, they have other, there are other options that they're, what I'm saying is that there are other options that they're working towards for increasing our water storage, and as they rank them in terms of cost effectiveness, the reservoir option was near the bottom in terms of cost effectiveness of storage per dollar expended.
I don't know how far it is as the crow flies to Kanopolis Lake, but that's a fur piece. And if you dig a trench 7 feet deep, 2 feet wide for 20 plus miles, that's a lot of dirt. That's a pretty big hole.
Yeah.
And that's not a free project either.
You know, as I thought about this after our last meeting, it's been a passion of mine. There's no question about that. I mean, you all know that, and I've never, but I thought, 20 years ago, I could have stood at the intersection of 435 and I-70 in Wyandotte County and said, that's a piece of junk ground off to the northwest. It is hilly, it's rolly, it's rocky, it's got rivers, creeks. It's a terrible development site. And I think Wyandotte County and Kansas City, Kansas decided they could turn that into something. And so Cabela's was built, Nebraska Furniture was built, and Legends was built, the ballpark was built, motels have been built, restaurants have been built, Kansas Speedway came in, and I think today they would be hard-pressed to say that wasn't probably a good investment. So it's a matter of a vision, knowing it's expensive, or you can say you can, or you can say you can't. That's the point. That's the difference. And I don't know, I'm not a developer, I don't know if this has any potential or not, but I can tell you it's a pretty busy highway, and 135 is a pretty busy highway, just sort of like 435 and 70 was in Kansas City. We're not Kansas City. I'm not proposing that, and I'm not saying that. But there's parts of that area of Kansas City that are not well developed, but they carved out a piece and said, we can, and together they did it. And so I'm just saying, you know, we created, I think, in this area of town, north of the levee on 9th Street, I'm not sure, but we may have created probably that part of that floodplain problem when we put up the levee around Salina. Before, the water would have flown right through the whole town. And now we force it all to flow between I-70 and the levee by intent. Yeah. So we created our own problem, and then said, I guess we washed our hands of that area when we decided to put the levee where we did. I don't know. I'm not a planner. But I'm saying, is there a way to fix it and make it better using some commercial, using some ag, using some green space? I personally think there is. If nothing else, we can clean the place up and make it look better than it does, if nothing else, and that's not terribly expensive. So that's my comment.
Since we've heard a couple other ideas, I just to get a sense of size, how far would you have to dig a channel to go over to the Saline River? A couple miles if you're going down Stimmel, isn't it?
Yeah, it would be a little more than a mile to go from 9th to Ohio. And then you would have to get past Ohio and far enough east, because what you're working against is that the Saline River is angling to the east at the same time that you're going that direction. So I don't know if John's going to keep
on the wraparound levee idea. How far would that levee have to be extended from? There to get up to Mulberry.
What you'd have to do to protect, and there is a non-core kind of a levee over by Roberts Truck Center and along part of Bosselman's, but it didn't do any good, and I can I don't know the particulars, but I know that there was a lawsuit in 2007 from those business owners against KDOT from some changes that KDOT did with the interchange that actually made the flooding worse there. But what you'd have to do is that you'd have to have some sort of levee on the west side of this loop to protect these properties from flooding from Mulberry Creek. Yeah. And then over here, you would have to have a levee on the running along the west side there. And what I'm afraid of is that the one area that doesn't benefit from any of that is this motel site right here, because the only way you could really protect it would be to build a levee on both sides of Mulberry Creek. If you built a levee on this side to protect this site, then you're going to flood this, so you'd have to do both. But if you had a levee over here, that would protect this area from this eastward movement, and then you'd construct a levee here on the inside to protect this area. But that would not protect this area here, although it would be protected by this levee. But basically, you'd have to link this levee up and virtually tie it into the interstate, which serves as a levee, and then you'd have to, that would keep the water out of the developed areas. But we are, we're expending quite a bit of money yet in this area right here as part of our levy certification to raise a couple of these areas to get it up to 100-year flood protection. But Mr. Kennedy is correct, just remembering that, again, when this levy was conceived of, Highway 40 down here was the artery, and so the goal was to protect this part of Salina, and Commerce went through on Pacific Avenue, and this was not even a known commodity. It was the interstate that came along about 5 years later that changed the fate of this area. And while this tie is not good, this area up here is mostly floodplain, which means that it can be built upon if properly elevated, and that's why you have seen some. You've seen the new Petrolube facility, you've seen a Holiday Inn Express, you've seen some new development on that side because you can build there if you elevate.
I appreciate the perspective. I'm just wondered, it's nice to keep the big ideas on the table, but frankly, you know, we don't have a strategic asset of a Schilling Air Force Base here anymore. We're not the fourth largest grain milling operation in the world. We don't have a president sitting in the White House when all these things were going on. The levee was being built in I-70. I think it's unlikely that it's a nice division like that, but it's unlikely things like that are going to happen for a town of 50,000 anymore. It's a pretty big dollar projects, so.
Well, if you did a cost-benefit analysis.
Thing is discussing our entryway ideas.
I would tend to agree with a lot of that, but my concern is that if we do nothing, or Ken, just to say if we're going to try to clean it up, we can't clean up what's there right now. We have absolutely no, other than code enforcement, we have absolutely no way of cleaning that up. The person or the owners, let's try to depersonalize it, the owners of several of those places have nothing to fear other than falling below the minimum maintenance code. And there isn't anybody who wants to buy that land, so why would they do anything? So if we don't try something that's a bigger thing, everybody would just shrug their shoulders and kick the dirt, and those run-down businesses will continue to be run down because that's all the land is valuable for. A farmer wouldn't even buy that. And even if a farmer did, if you look at that, there's not a lot of wheat production in that area.
No.
It's all next to a creek. Anybody with large equipment isn't going to want to in there mess around doing that. He might throw some brome grass in there and turn it into a meadow, but that would, you know.
Well, as we mentioned, I mean, there are areas, say, out around Cheyenne Bottoms or something where a landowner sells or donates their land to Nature Conservancy and takes a tax write-off for that, and there are organizations out there like that. If there was a agreed-upon civic vision that where everybody was on board that was going to be an open space corridor, there may be civic-minded individuals or corporations or others that either through purchase or donation or other things may be able to acquire property up and down that corridor and gradually convert that to an open space use. But I mean, that's part of the discussion, is that this is kind of in that it's hard because people see the existing commercial development there, and it's kind of in this no man's land between it being a commercial area, and you can't really call it an open space area because it's mostly in private ownership. And so that was part of it, is that you need to have a more defined vision. Is it primarily commercial? Is status quo isn't really going to help anything? And the other vision is to say, you know what, this really isn't a very prime redevelopment corridor, and maybe the vision needs to be that it's primarily a conservation area and get people behind that idea. But even the comprehensive plan wasn't very decisive. It shows it as green conservation area and then splotches a commercial on top of it to try to protect the existing zoning and businesses.
I think there are all kinds of issues. I mean, clearly there are all kinds of issues about water and how floodway and water usage could play into this. But I would like to see the Planning Commission be on record as suggesting this kind of use, a recreational conservation public use area that would be attractive along the lines, for example, of the gateways that were suggested in the North Salina study, and that Salina remain open to and promote ways of developments over the next. I'm mindful, by the way, of the handout that you gave us, Dean, saying the good planning commissions look 40 years in the future, but that we look at that as a primary goal for that area, seemingly in some fashion achievable goal. That I think that's pretty simply stated.
Well, we do have the floodplain works for us. I mean, it limits a lot of things there. I kind of agree with staff on the notion of finding some ways to push that towards a conservancy area, and with it in mind that this is a gateway and aesthetics are important through there. So yeah. There were ideas on the table about an overlay or some form of that pushed in those directions. I'd like to hear those conversations. I could be in favor of that.
What has the motel guy up there on the west side? I mean, he's vacant. Ken and I were up there several weeks ago, and I mean, it's pretty disgusting. But I mean, does he ever have a chance of going in and rebuilding that thing, or is it best just to kind of figure out some way to get him out of there and to turn it into?
Well, what we said is that you in the world of floodway regulation, you get credit for the obstruction that you have, and the easiest thing to do would be to do a rehabilitation that kept it. You might make this taller or longer or whatever, but kept that, this is what they refer to, the shadow of the flow. So the flow is going this way, and when a flooding comes, these are obstructions, and you couldn't, and you might be able to hire an engineer and say, well, I'm getting rid of this, and I'm getting rid of this, and I'm concentrating it into this, but it would take a very competent hydrologic engineer to come up with the calculations and everything and show that what I was going back here to build was equivalent in terms of the obstruction as what's there today.
That didn't flood. That particular parcel didn't flood in the 07, did
only
it?
Only the access to it.
The access
as
so it's elevated
as much. It is elevated.
Right, it's out of that.
On the other hand, There was a farmhouse and some outbuildings here, and they are now gone because they were destroyed in that flood.
But is that parcel there, can that be developed in its current configuration, since it is apparently elevated out of the flood way?
Well, if somebody wanted to retake these existing structures and rehabilitate them and remodel them and add another floor or utilize those footprints, someone could creatively do that. But what we tried to emphasize that it's only doable if you utilize the existing footprints that are there, because those are pre-regulation. They actually,
they're grandfathered.
Yeah, this property, that they actually have a letter of map amendment for the motel structures because they are elevated above the flood elevation. Nonetheless, they are an obstruction in the floodway. So the other aspect of that is there's a lot of programs out there, whether it's federally insured mortgages or whether it's Small Business Administration loans or other programs, where they're not going to lend or touch this property because their job is to discourage flood losses in a floodway and not increase, because increased property values in floodways means increased flood losses potentially later, and so it would be challenging for someone to get federal government assistance or subsidies or utilize their programs when you have a floodway property.
When will some code enforcement kick in on it? There are at least 8 or 10 of the large windows and some doors out of it as of this morning. As of 11 o'clock this morning, I drove by and looked at it.
We had a discussion on that. I know that Susan, our code enforcement officer, is working on that now, but it's more than she can handle, so she's going to need some assistance from a couple of the building inspectors to do that and get that done. We've been having trouble getting in contact with Mr. Bakta to get that done, and so if we have to do that ourselves, that will be a little more challenging. But they have not, we've been attempting to contact him about that and have not been able to reach him.
He was just here.
He was just.
When I walked in, he stopped me in the hall.
Well, maybe he's coming in to visit with the code enforcement folks.
Could have been, yeah. Well, I wonder what kind of a value that location has.
Well, any location that has access and frontage on an interstate that's heavily traveled has some value to it. Yeah, except when it floods.
Now,
so
does Bosselman still flood and Robert still flood down there?
Sure.
Yes. We showed you some. The city, I think we lost 3 vehicles that we had at Roberts Truck Center for repairs, and they were completely submerged and were not salvageable after the flood. So, yes, it did flood, and a part of that was there was some work here that KDOT did along here that seemed to have aggravated the flood or made it more difficult for the water to flow away, and there was some settlement reached with KDOT relating to that. But the fact of the matter is, this is Mulberry Creek. There was a 100-year flood event on it in 2007, and when it has a 100-year flood, it really spreads out.
No, I don't want to be flip. I was talking to a person, an esteemed person who I won't mention, that was talking about, well, you know, maybe we need to save our money for this side of the levee and try to encourage development south of the levee but in North Salina as opposed to north on the interstate. And here's the flip part of the answer is maybe we just need to put a big sign up there instead of welcome to Salina. Welcome to Salina. Don't give up. Just drive a mile south. It'll get better. because I think, you know, I just don't see much. I'm becoming extremely hopeless here unless I have $200 million in my pocket. And that's not impossible to do. I mean, there are organizations that cause voters to decide that that's a good investment in a matter of a mere 3 or 4 years, let alone 30 or 40. And so I think I'm ready to just wash my hands of this unless we can do something that's going to do something. I mean, not wash my hands of it, but let's just say, well, we're going to do the best we can and move on.
Well, you know, after the last meeting, I called for the North Salina Development Plan. I'd seen it previously, but didn't have a chance to read it closely. And one thing we could do that doesn't commit the city, doesn't commit us, but it is give some credibility to what the North Salina Development Group is trying to do. They've taken some initial steps, and they've got some ideas in their plan, in their initial plan, that really makes some sense if you look at it. And maybe if we stand behind them and say, you know, move forward, do a little more planning, a little more. They seem to be energized to get grants and so forth, to get a planner in to look at it. And that's one thing we could do, because they've started that process. We don't have to reinvent the wheel. Let's let them start. And they may come to the conclusion that it can't be used for this or it can be used for that. But they really have the energy and the enthusiasm for it. I think we give them some credit for what they've done and allow them to and encourage them to move forward and give them a little support somehow.
Ken, what are some of those ideas that you find pretty likely?
It's some are in there. And then, you know, it talks about gateway landscaping features should be installed.
Right.
The hotel at the southeast corner of the interchange should be redeveloped. That's the one we've been talking about.
Right.
Existing creeks present an opportunity for more formalized flood control measures. We've talked about that.
Yeah.
The mobile home sales site can be converted into another use. That's one of the things we've sort of mentioned. The public and natural areas on the north end of 9th Street should be connected to areas south by multi-use trails. The levee trail should be extended to create a more extensive trail loop or system and should be connected to the neighborhoods to the south. There's several. It goes on. They expand a public nursery, wind and solar energy in that area where appropriate. In the floodplain area, they specifically state. They have got a whole litany of ideas here that I think all have some merit.
So almost all, perhaps all of the ones that we have in our packet then, you think are,
similar. And so I just say they've done some good work. Maybe it will come to fruition. Maybe it will not. But let's give them encouragement.
Yeah. I happened to see a column written by somebody that I think is a fairly astute observer of just development and of sustainable development in particular. And one of his observations was that it is sometimes a mistake to think that localism, just buying local, getting local grocery stores, as much as I'm in favor of that, are a solution. Given that we have to recognize how much corporate money in the amounts that Commissioner Boxa suggested are what can really move things. If you need $200 million, maybe there's something around there. If an entity sees a way of, hopefully for a public-private deal to do that. And I'm thinking, for example, the kind of reservoirs that could be created, and it might well be that we could. There are going to be some engineering, great engineering difficulties. But my point is that, again, to echo Commissioner Boxa, if we talk about developing in the way that we can south of the levee and yet remain open to some of these suggestions north of the levee and encourage looking at that through the city, as well as having the Chamber of Commerce encourage people to come in and look at how that might be developed. Public recreation, there are a lot of uses that could be made and could be quote-unquote profitable. So I don't feel hopeless. In fact, I sort of feel hopeful in that, with that in mind.
Well, I don't feel hopeless either, and I think that the area is very much more cleaned up now than it was 5 years ago. The work that the city's done to clean up that mobile home place is huge, and there's much less storage of building materials and things going on out there. I agree with Ken that we could give some kind of slap on the back to the North Salina's work, because I do agree with, I think, all of the things listed for the 9th Street corridor.
So I think we're making progress.
And it wasn't necessarily this group that's here today, but what we promised to do was say we'll put this back on as a regular agenda item, and if there's something that you feel strongly you want to make a recommendation on, whether it's preferred land use vision, or if there's some flood control project or improvement option that you feel strongly about as a body, and you want to communicate that, this is the opportunity. Doesn't mean you have to. I think that the North Salina group senses that they're making some headway with the Planning Commission, City Commission, in terms of taking recognition of their different initiatives they have. But as we explained, that this corridor is almost kind of stuck in time, and it's a piece, a snapshot of the 1960s and 70s when this wasn't a floodway and you could build stuff there, and it's either going to stay in a status quo condition, or we can move the needle in one direction, redevelopment, which we think takes some flood control measures, or recognize that that's not likely to occur, and maybe the preferred scenario is transitioning to public and semi-public open space over time. So
I feel that an unencumbered natural floodway is a valuable flood control asset, and the whole idea of having, I mean, going with the North Salina planning comments thus far, that's basically what they're saying also, that we need to move this back to an unencumbered natural or naturalistic floodway. That helps solve the flooding problems, and the only obstacles to that right now are like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's really only 5 businesses in that area. It's much more economical to help relocate those businesses than it would be to do any of these major mechanicalistic flood control things that we're talking about that could range up to $160 million. So essentially returning it and endorsing the undevelopment of the area, as it were, between the interstate and the levee makes the most economical sense to me. We don't have a shortage of developed commercial land in the C5 to C7 range that these things are currently zoned. We've got over 160 acres, I think, that have utilities on the north side between I-70 between Diamond Drive and Pleasant Valley Road that have Pleasant Hill Road, but it's in the valley there. But at any rate, that have utilities and have potential for development of the highway commercial nature. So, in effect, allowing the present operating motel to continue until they can't anymore is fine. If there's a serious redevelopment plan of the hotel that is now in disrepair and an object of vandalism, that would be fine, but it needs to be done soon. It needs to get started before the building is torn down by vandals and weather, not counting a flood. I mean, we may have another flood later this year, and that would help crystallize these things again. The church has weathered the past floods, the most recent floods, 93 and 07, pretty well. There's no reason that can't continue. So I think that we need some kind of a direction to follow that, to say that this area is not naturally well-suited for commercial development. We don't need more developable commercial land. We do need an attractive entrance, and if it were naturalistic or agriculturally or parkland, that sort of thing would be much better than it has been, and that it will be without hundreds of millions of dollars of expenditure. And then try to try to spend more money south of the existing levees, because there's lots of undeveloped and land that is marginally developed that needs to be redeveloped within the boundaries of our levee. There's nothing wrong with having a nice edge on the city, and the levee might as well be it. I don't know how to put that in a motion. Or I would.
Well, I think of the members, Mr. Bossmeyer was the one that expressed the strongest that he wanted an opportunity to have this back on so that if desired, there could be specific record. I said there's no reason that you have to go on the record and make any specific. We're not trying to twist your arms into that direction. We're simply trying to say from a realistic point of view, steering the compass more towards the public and natural area vision than the commercial redevelopment vision, we think is a more realistic vision given the circumstances, unless we just had a huge grant or a windfall money for a massive capital improvement program, but there's no, we're going to keep working with the North Salina group, we're going to keep bringing developments back to you, so there's no reason that you need to take any formal action, but we just wanted to have this as a carryover from your study session to see if there was anything you felt strongly about, and obviously all the comments that you're making are going into the minutes and we'll be part of the record of your discussion. So,
but Dean, don't you need something by way of formal direction?
Well,
otherwise, we're just saying, oh, that was the tenor of the meeting on April 15th, tax day, not 2014.
Watch the video.
Probably the most helpful thing from a direction standpoint for the North Salina group and for staff would be to look there on page 2, and if we said, as a group of the 6 people here present today, do you see the future preferred vision for this section of corridor as primarily commercial, and we need to do more to encourage commercial and redevelopment and do some things in that area about overlays or design guidelines, or this subject makes my head hurt and we just need to maintain the status quo, or do you see as a body that the future land use vision for this area, really we shouldn't be doing things to try to pump up commercial development, but actually work to transition this, look for opportunities to transition this corridor to open space over time.
Or why can't it be both? Why can't it be two? Why couldn't it be some commercial, which is what David talked about, some conservancy, which is what Abner talked about, and I think that both worlds could benefit from it. You can't, it's not really suited for all of one or all of the other, in a way, but it is kind of suited for a little bit of both, and as we just said, north of 70 could become commercial with a little work. Status quo doesn't exist. Status quo is a dream. If you just let things sit there, they continue to get worse, so it deteriorates. You either improve or you go backwards in a community. You don't have status quo. That's not an option, but I think a little of both is a good option. There's parts of that that needs to be conservancy. You know, there's a natural conservancy habitat area along I-70 on the north side between here and Topeka. You know, they're all over, and some of that needs to be that way, but there's some possible development there, which if commercial got involved and developers got involved, could do it.
Dina, were you going to say that the area north of Diamond Drive is not necessarily in our plan?
Well, I'm saying what we're talking about today starts at the interstate and comes down to here. And the reason we distinguish that is that the floodway runs from the interstate to the levee, and north is not predominantly floodway, so the characteristics are different. You could also have an approach that's maybe different on the east side than on the west side. But I guess kind of what we're saying is that the What you have is, when you look at the land use plan, this is all lime green for conservation area. This is all lime green for conservation area. If this is lime green for conservation area, and then it's got a red area overlaid the top of it for commercial. But when you have that, you're living in both worlds. You're not, so from our perspective, if you're not aggressively moving towards commercial development or redevelopment, then you are in the status quo mode, just protecting what's already, the businesses that are already there.
Well, and I concur with Commissioner Purney's comments about the commercial areas, and so I feel schizophrenic about, I would say protect or promote within existing commercial areas, except that I'm seeing that as primarily along the interstate exchange. They're not in the corridor on into 9th Street, because it would make sense to have that entire area be conservation / recreation, with a possible exception of that, of the church / hotel, which is, has kind of a distinguished architectural feature and might be useful in some ways. So I don't know how to summarize that.
Could we play around with the mixed-use zoning ideas and some kind of overlay and make it more spot site-specific, like the west side moves towards conservancy, and then those portions that are already commercially developed and are out of the floodplain just by virtue of they've lasted so long?
What we can do is we can bring back to you kind of a, which we had talked about following up with a study session on North Ohio, on so we can compare North Ohio with North 9th and get everybody updated on that. But on North Ohio, we do have a corridor overlay district that runs of different widths, but primarily 500 feet back from Ohio on both sides. It has specifications on the orientation of buildings, on landscaping, on where parking is, on building materials. It has a long list of uses that are prohibited in the corridor. All those, we can share that with you, and as you could see what elements you like of that, and you might want to transfer to 9th Street.
Dave, when you say North Ohio, do you mean in town,
in
past
town,
Pacific,
it applies,
South Pacific?
It applies basically in the area up around Harley-Davidson, Kenworth, that area. And then from the levee, there's been disappointment on City Commission and Planning Commission level about what A-plus galvanizing looks like in terms of coming into the city from the north, and that was part of the prompting. Some of the stuff that is development that is nearby are expensive. Overpass isn't very attractive and could certainly use, and there is a lot of vacant land in there that we would, that is developable in the Ohio Pacific intersection area, that the idea was to have some guidelines in place so when development did occur that it was of a higher standard. And we can certainly share some of the concepts on that with you and see what of that you might want to apply to 9th Street.
Yeah. Well, I think that's a good idea. But to put it as simply as possible, I think that I would urge a resolution, whether today or later, that the primary focus of our development discussion be on the preferred land use vision number 3, primarily conservation area, but add to that conservation and recreation.
So we will be scheduling a study session for you on North Ohio, and we'll share some of those things. We'll after doing that, we'll bring this back yet again and see if you want to give us some specific direction on some things for this corridor.
Well, so I want to ask, does adopting, if we adopted that resolution with a motion and a second here, does that, would that impede the process you're talking about, Dean?
No. It would help the North Salina Development Group, and it would help the City Commission in terms of communicating what the vision would be.
Well, I would move that we adopt that resolution that I just stated.
What was that?
That primary emphasis be given to preferred land use vision number 3, with the addition of the word "and recreation." Primarily conservation and recreation.
I would second that.
Okay.
Well, I'm not going to, I'm concerned about that a little bit because of the bullet that everybody is not talking about is the transition of the corridor to public.
Or quasi-public.
Yeah. It should just not have a lot of public in there. I'm afraid if we do, the City of Salina doesn't need that much more public land to do things on, take care of, clean up. I'm concerned that we already have enough parks, enough golf courses, and things like that. And that becomes a burden. If we talk about the cost of infrastructure to do a big project, I was just messing around. Let's say that the city somehow miraculously got that whole strip of land on the west to do something with. Mm-hmm. Just once it was done, how many people do you think it would take just to maintain it? Whenever it was done with, whatever we decided, it was an orchard or whatever, it would probably be 2 or 3 employees just to maintain that property.
And we're talking about cutting back 20 staff.
At about, maybe $150,000 a year, and in 10 years you got $1.5 million or $2 million just to maintain an area.
But, Jerry, aren't there two caveats in that line, one being overtime and one being quasi-public? Well, aren't those kind of escape clauses leaving you free of that encumbrance?
The other thing you could do is just possibly leave that phrase out. Just say transition the corridor to open space over time, and don't say who's going to own it. For the purposes
I would be
of
better
moving
with that.
On,
yeah,
I and with that. It could be a private conservancy. It could be there's discussion of having a North Salina land bank, and there's all kinds of ramifications of how a land bank could work. But one of the things a land bank could do is end up owning land that is merely recreational and open space.
And I would accept that as a friendly amendment, given this is just a resolution of direction. We're not putting in law here.
These are all direction to go.
These have all been good ideas, but I just think it's sort of premature to commit to a resolution. I'd like to have more discussion about it and hear further from the staff. So this has all been instructive to me, but I don't think that I want to resolve anything at this point.
And I agree with Carl. I think we've had a lot of good ideas, had a lot of good discussion, and there's a lot of work yet to be done. There's a lot of other groups working on it. I like the idea of looking at Ohio and what's planned there. I think we're premature to make a commitment to what might be the future of that. There's a lot of others involved, and so I don't know where the City Commission is on this, so I would say I agree. I'm not going to be in favor of this.
So do we have a motion or not?
Any other discussion?
I thought we had a second.
There's a motion and a second.
A motion and a second. Is there any other discussion? We'll call the question.
Well, I suggested that amendment to not designate what kind of ownership there would be on the open space.
And you indicated that was acceptable. So the motion would be to adopt the
and
third
Mr. Story,
bullet, primary conservation
acceptable.
Area,
and recreation,
and delete the public, any public ownership.
Right.
Okay. Any other discussion before we call the question? All in favor of the motion that was made and then somewhat friendly amended, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
Nay.
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 We're going to need hands, I think.
Mr. Vice Chair, Mr. Chairman.
Can we have hands, please? The three in favor? Three in favor and three opposed?
That's correct.
Okay.
So it dies for lack of a majority.
Happens?
So we're in the secretary.
It just dies for lack of a majority. Until we do something again another time.
Survivor A was all wrong.
Sorry.
But there's still plenty of goodwill to go around.
That's right.
Item number four.
Item number four, John will have you put that up on the screen, and this is simply a homework item for you. What we're going to do is we have created this handout for you, and we're going to place this in your meeting notebooks that you have up there available for your meetings, and it is your guide to go back and refer to when the term mixed use is thrown around. It's thrown around at city commission meetings. It's discussed in the comprehensive plan. It's kind of a buzzword, and this is our efforts to try to give a fairly thorough explanation of what the concept means. And on page 13 of that handout is what you should really be paying attention to, and that we'll be coming back to as we discuss the different areas. Is there a chance of getting that on the screen, John?
Okay.
So we've called this decision points, but this is what, as we work towards these concepts, neighborhood center, commercial center, what our classic example of where we have a mixed-use district today is the downtown area, and your classic example of mixed use would be the building where you have a office or jewelry store on the first floor and loft apartment on the second floor. You've got a vertical mixed use. That pattern could be extended to other places. And if you want to scroll down, John, some of the decision points. Some communities have a board similar to in the downtown area. We have a Lee District Design Review Board that reviews development plans that relate to what occurs in the Lee District. That is a possibility. Many communities use their planning commission or city commission to be that review body for development plans. We have some concept areas identified, but no boundaries established. That would be a step. We've had some discussions. Mixed use has talked a lot about commercial residential. We've had some discussion up in the Broadway corridor, up along Pacific Avenue, of an area where you would have mixed commercial industrial districts as some of those areas transition away from retail or commercial areas and allow for either commercial or industrial in a mixed-use setting. We've had discussions about downzoning, particularly in the Broadway corridor, what important design elements. Mixed-use development also implies that you've got some criteria about what it's going to look like in terms of height and orientation from the street and lot coverage and things like that. And then the most challenging thing of all is that staff could probably sit down and draw up an ordinance or a set of mixed-use development standards, but there's going to have to be a process for educating and getting buy-in from the development community and other stakeholders, including landowners, and that's going to be the most challenging part and where we would need the input from you the most. So these 7 points here are the things that we're going to be working with you on in the future, as we need your input as decision points to try to work in that direction to make sure that our zoning rules that we have in place do not discourage but rather encourage mixed-use development. So we have we have put together, we call it a handbook or anything else, but it's intended to be a reference guide, and it kind of follows up on the study session that our intern Ashley put on in the summer. But again, this is going to end up in your notebooks or for you to have as a handbook or guide when you keep hearing people talk about mixed use. What does that mean in terms of, and how does it look differently than the development patterns we see today? So this is not an action item, but something we just wanted to update you on, and that will basically three-hole punch for you and put in your notebooks, and you have this available as an educational reference, because the concept's going to keep coming up and coming up and coming up, so that prepares you for that.
We sort of already have that in Salina, don't we, at the corner of Cloud and 9th Street. Mixed-use zoning, because that mall, that plaza in there has got loft apartments and all business below.
Craft Manor would be an example of that.
And then the fitness center across the street, we've got outdoor plantings on one corner and then businesses.
And a college nearby.
And a college nearby, yeah.
That's right. Yeah.
Where to have it?
The college owns part of that, where the plants are.
Right.
I wonder if I could make a request that for the commissioners, at least for me, I would assume that there's an electronic PDF file of this stuff. If it could be sent to us, it would help me, because I start looking for papers wherever they are, three-hole punched or otherwise, and sometimes I'm at a loss. But I can put it in a folder in my email, and similarly in another file, and I'll be able to just go right to it.
Okay.
So I'd appreciate that.
Is the handbook online?
We could put it online, put it on our website.
That's a good idea.
We would probably post that on the planning page of our website, yes. I think that would be helpful.
I'm wondering at this moment how up-to-date I've kept mine since I started.
Right.
I second Mr. Ryan's good idea.
Other items?
Our other items is we have a flood mapping update, and that is in your packet. I actually put a date on it this time so I could keep track of these, because this is drug out and drug out. But we have been told that there will be some sort of preliminary rollout or scoping meeting that will occur before the end of this month. And then there's been a little bit of delay on getting a core approval for our levy modifications. So we thought we'd have the certification complete sometime this spring. It's more likely to be bid out in May or June and completed in the fall. There's going to be a period of time in June and July when maps will come to staff, and we will pore over them and look for misinformation, bad information, obvious errors, get that back to them, and then probably in August or September will be the official preliminary map release, and there'll be a 90-day community review period. And if you'll recall, last time we had a community meeting at the Bicentennial Center, and we provided information, and we had stations set up where people could come and look at their property specifically, or if they had a letter of map amendment, determine those things. And then that period's going to end. There's an appeal period. And then I think one of the major things that may involve you is that we will be required to re-look at our floodplain regulations, and there may be some changes that we have to make. And the most significant thing that I think sometimes goes unnoticed, but staff was able at the last go-around to have Salina approved as an at or above community, which means that if you are in a mapped floodplain area in Salina you can build a building that is at or above the 100-year flood elevation in Saline County and most other jurisdictions. It is a 1 foot above requirement, and for building purposes and other purposes in a very flat community like Salina that is protected by levees on all sides, that 1 foot can really make a large impact. And so the at or above has been an important, it does, has protected those areas from flooding, but doesn't give you the artificial buildup that you have when the necessity for more and more and more fill to artificially elevate things when you have to build 1 foot above. So that'll probably be part of act. Just wanted you to have that so you could get this mentally on your calendar.
I did read correctly. The levee's been recertified, right?
It has not.
Oh, I misread that.
We are, there are two areas that are up by Thomas Park, ironically both up in the west of and east of North 9th Street, that were determined to be lower than needed to provide 100-year flood protection.
Yeah.
A plan has been developed for raising those sections, and we're waiting on the Corps of Engineers to approve that. Then that will go out to bid. They'll be raised, and then we should be able to certify all the way around that we have 100-year protection.
How much are we talking about raising the levee?
6 inches in some places, slightly more than a foot over by the Thomas Park area over there. It was determined that we have great protection from Smoky Hill River, less great protection from Mulberry Creek. So that is where the emphasis is on the Mulberry Creek side of our levee system.
They could pour an extra thick concrete bike trail on top of there then, couldn't they? And my bikers would love it, and we'd certify the levee.
We wanted to call attention to two items that we put in your packet. One was a national study summarizing nationwide the composition of who serves on planning commissions and by profession, and then some information on communicating in the electronic age. And then the final item there was just to share that one thing we're not having to deal with yet is in the Colorado, they had $14 million in sales the first month of their recreational marijuana sales. But many of the cities are struggling, and planning commissions are struggling with sorting out the appropriate zoning and locations and all for the stores and shops. And so that's not one thing we have to deal with right now, but I thought I would share that with you. And the on the recreational side as opposed to the medical side, the state of Colorado and localities have some pretty steep taxation on that, so they've actually are generating quite a bit in taxes. For if you can see, $14 million in sales and $3.5 million in taxes, a portion of which will fund school construction.
What happened to hookah bars?
City attorney is still working on some things before we advertise that and bring that back for you. We're still researching and gathering information from other communities. But our background reports and things will be pretty voluminous, and so we want to make sure we have that lined up and give proper advance notice to our local establishments that are currently selling the e-cigarettes and other types of devices. There's two that are fully that, and then there's some others like Pack Rat Smokes and others that are It's not their primary business, but they do make them available. So we're making sure we identify our stakeholders before we start having public meetings.
I don't think this is going to be a prejudicial comment, but National Public Radio last week had a study about e-cigarettes and that there can be harm to the lungs as well when you're introducing something foreign into your lung. So, yeah.
About the people around them.
Surgeon General.
Yes.
Yeah, so there will be, as I discussed this with the city attorney, there's two sides to this coin. The side that you're working on is the shops, the availability of the products, the lounges, the locations of such. The other decision that needs to be made is that we have a ordinance that prohibits indoor smoking in theaters, restaurants, public buildings. It currently does not address e-cigarettes, and that's a case around the country where communities are trying to decide, does the ban on indoor smoking or should it extend to the e-cigarettes? So that is not a zoning question that you will be dealing with. We will be dealing with the proper location and zoning, understanding what the activity is and then what's the proper location for it. So we will be meeting on the your first meeting in May, and we have a lighter agenda than tonight for you.
Good to know.
Anything else?
I'm glad that we have a pretty good representation of the balance here. It was good.
Lawyers, educators. Different languages together, a history of